one of the trips to Guatemala, the kids did that, I think it was in Antigua. And oh my word, just brings back such memories. I don't know how the kids were, that must have been 25 years ago, huh? 30 more? 30 years ago. Wow. Wow. 50 years ago, my kids and I were down there. Wow. Except for when they do it down there, they'd be surrounded by machine guns, literally. I mean, it was definitely intimidating, no matter what. But it was awesome. I often had thought, what am I doing bringing my kids down here? Jeez. Oh, my. Anyways, Rich.
You know you make me wanna shout, kick my heels up and shout, throw my hands up and shout, throw my head back and shout, come on now, don't forget to say you will, don't forget to say yeah, 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 yeah,
that's right.
The bunny hop. I forgot about that one. Thank you, Rich. That was perfect. Get the old blood flowing a little bit. Okay. So, try not to offend anybody today. But I have to tell you, Jesus was not trying to win a popularity contest when he was around sharing. He spoke the truth. You'd be amazed at how many people really don't like the truth. We're going to, before we start, we're going to pray for the Sphinx.
Their youngest daughter, Joy Lynn, actually had met Ryan and Kyle at the International House of Prayer in Kansas City. And Joy Lynn had said, you should look up the House of Prayer in Big Bear, which was Kristen and I. And so we met them and invited them here. And now they're more a part of the church than we are. Truly, truly, these guys serve with all their heart. So... I'd say we're going to miss you, but we're not. We're going to come visit you.
That's right.
Often.
That's right.
So.
John, why don't you grab a mic and lead out in prayer if you could?
Lord, thank you for Kevin and Diana. Lord, we just love them. You know, you guys blessed Tracy and I. And we're praying a hundredfold return for everything you do, not just for us, because I know we're just in line of many that you've blessed. And so, Lord, I just ask the return go on their heads, just from head to toe, your anointing, your power, your provision, all of that, Lord Jesus. We thank you for it. Thank you for what they've done here, the good works that they've done. Lord, the blessings that they've been to this congregation. Well, we thank you for that. Lord, as we send them off and send them with peace, travel, mercies, all those things, God, that we trust you for. Protect them in every way. And we give you praise, Lord, and thanks. And bless your children, too, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Anybody else want to pray? Okay. I didn't want them all to hear that. Okay. Back in the 60s, what was popular, at least on the college campuses and stuff like that, when I was going to school, it was the funniest, it was a funny time going from high school to the colleges back then that were just in turmoil and where's your head at and who am I and what am I doing here and what's it all about, Alfie? I mean, those were the questions that we were asking. It was comedy to me. I wasn't as smart as these guys. But I did realize what the answer was. It was one word. The answer to all their questions was Jesus. That was it. You know, when the Jesus movement really got into full swing, I mean, to have been there was just a crack up. You couldn't pick up any, you pick up a hitchhiker and they'd jump in the car, and as soon as they got in, this big smile would come all over their face with their totally bad breath because they've been, they're homeless still, but they got saved and they're so happy. And it was just, it was a fascinating, oh, thank you, thank you. Now we have new rules about coffee. No, seriously, seriously. Seriously, the new rules are you can drink coffee in the sanctuary if you have a, what is it? No, not a Yeti. It's got to be a spill proof. Spill proof. I have one outside. He'll bring it in a minute. Yeah. I apologize for breaking the rules. But if I do spill, I will pay for the carpet to be cleaned. Okay. Yes. Mm-mm. No. You have to put coffee in it, and you have to bring it with you, otherwise you cannot bring coffee in. And that is called the coffee police. Or you will be fined $25 every time you do that. I think that's a great idea. That's one way to make money. Wow. Well, good. We got to do something. I keep breaking all the rules, and I don't want to be like that. So, we know that in that one word was all the answers. And in the time, you couldn't go anywhere without hearing about Jesus, particularly on the campuses. Everybody you bump into is either part of the Jesus movement or they're rejecting it, but they're all talking about Jesus, good or bad, one way or the other. But you find out who Jesus is, and you find out who you are. You see, you find out who Jesus is, and you're going to find out your answers in life. You're not going to wonder about what to do and your purpose and your destiny when you find out who Jesus is. Right. Now, if you're just talking about Jesus, you're not going to necessarily know Jesus. But you can know Him. And one of the keys to the kingdom that we were talking about, we started with, was that knowledge, was knowing Him is going to be the ultimate key, the most precious key. So we're talking about the keys of the kingdom of God in order that we might experience kingdom living here on earth, right? But we have to do a lot of background stuff. So we're going to slowly build a foundation for this. And so I need you to be patient, and I need you just to be logging this thing. So in Mark chapter 1, verse 15, it says, "The time has come." This is Jesus talking. People are sort of wondering, what did Jesus really preach? And it says, He said, "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." It wasn't just John the Baptist that was preaching repentance. Jesus also preached it. He preached the kingdom of God, the good news, and repentance. His message was, in another version, at last the fulfillment of the age has come. That moment in time has come. The Messiah was here. And it says, it is time for God's kingdom to be experienced in its fullness. That's what another version says out of the 63 that we have. Turn your lives back to God and put your trust in the hope-filled gospel. Again, what did Jesus preach and what was he doing? Matthew 4:23. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogue, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. He wasn't just proclaiming the good news, the gospel, but it was specific. It was the good news of the kingdom. And then it says after that, and healing and every disease and sickness among the people. So he did that. He preached this good news. And then these things took place. In the Amplified version of Matthew 4:23, it says, and he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the good news or the gospel of the kingdom. You see, because this becomes important when we find out exactly what the keys of the kingdom are for and what they are. Okay? So just keep logging this. He went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the good news, the gospel, of the kingdom, healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness among the people, demonstrating and revealing that he was indeed the promised Messiah. So now he's fulfilling prophecy so that they would obviously see, well, these things are taking place, he must be the Messiah. The CEV says, Jesus went all over Galilee, teaching in the Jewish meetings places and preaching the good news about God's kingdom. This is what he's preaching. The good news of God's kingdom. Keys of the kingdom. Kingdom of God. The dome, domain, dominion, where the king has dominion. Right? That's kingdom. Or where the king reigns. What is the kingdom of God? Luke 17:20-21. Let's read that. Let's start reading the Bible. Luke 17, Matthew, Mark, Luke 17. Oh, we're going to have some fun today. 17:21. Let's do 20. Once on being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come. Oh, they're just straight up about that. They want to know about this kingdom of God. They're waiting for the Messiah. Jesus replied, the coming of the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed, nor will people say, here it is and there it is, because the kingdom of God is in your midst. Amen. So that's like not seeing the forest because of the trees or the trees because of the forest. It's right there in front of you. Have you ever done that, looking for something? And it was right there in front of you. You're looking over here, you're looking over there, and all you had to do was to look down, and there it was. The Amplified says, nor will people say, look, here it is, or there it is, for the kingdom of God is amongst you because of my presence. Other versions say the kingdom of God is inside you, in the midst of you, right here, right now. The kingdom of God has come. Remember in the Lord's Prayer, he says, let's pray thy kingdom come. We're in the midst. But now it's in us. Right. Now it's everywhere. Amen. It's everywhere that God has reign. Yeah, right. What is the kingdom of God not? Turn to 1 Corinthians 4:18. 1 Corinthians 4. I was mentioning this. This is where it is. To those that I was talking to earlier. 4:18. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. Amen. The kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. Let's go back to 18. Some of you have become Eric. So now, Paul's talking to the Corinthians. He's not there, but he's saying, listen, I'm going to be coming, and some of you guys are talking smack. Whatever you're talking, it's not lining up with the Word of God. Some of you are becoming arrogant, as if I'm not coming to see you. I'm coming. Jesus is coming, and Paul's coming. Paul's saying, listen, I'm coming. You're talking? We're going to have a chat. Now, I will come to you very soon, if the Lord is willing. And then I'll find out not only how these arrogant people are talking, he's going to listen to them, but what power they have. He's not looking just for the talk. He's looking for the power. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk. Does that ever bother you? You can turn the radio on and you get, what's it called? Talk radio. We get it constantly. You can get preaching and all that kind of over and over and all that stuff. And it's all wonderful. But he says it's not about the talking. There's an action to this whole thing. Talk is cheap, boys and girls. Talk is really cheap. You can just say it anyway. There's no necessarily accountability that goes along with it. Action. Power. And we know what Paul says before, that he didn't come with eloquent words, but he came with power and demonstration. Are we missing something? No, I mean, are all the churches missing something? I mean, you can go to a place and just pray. That doesn't mean you have anything to do with power. Oh, I feel so good. That's not power. What is this? Everyone was healed. All the sickness and disease that he touched, he healed them. Does that sound like power to you?
Yes.
I'm thinking so. I'm thinking that sounds like power. I mean, we must be playing a whole lot of church if we're not seeing a whole lot of power. Can I say, can I hear somebody say, amen? Can I read this one again? For the king, it's a short one, you know. Verse 20. For the kingdom of God is not. Isn't that a funny thing? We talk about what it is. And he said, I'm going to tell you what it's not. It's not about just talking all the time. You got the answers? I don't want to hear it. I want to see the answer. Wow. Listen, God's moving us. And you don't have to move. You can go somewhere else and sit in the pew and listen to the same old Sunday school stories and go home feeling good about yourself because you endured the hour of somebody's preaching or whatever. Or you could say, you know, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ, arise and walk. Amen. I mean, have you ever put yourself in that position? Have you ever felt that? He's coming to the guy, people around. He wants money. Listen, I don't have any money, but such as I have, here it comes. Arise and walk. Wow. That's powerful. Arise and walk. You know what it takes? It takes pure faith, that's all. Not a big deal. Don't have to have silver or gold. Don't have to have an education. You don't have to be the best looking person around. Don't have to wear Gucci pants. That's good. I can't fit in those pants anymore. I'm a Levi man because you can get the relaxed fit. Our scripture, our text, is Matthew 16. But in order to understand 16, we have to go back, and we did this before, we went back to Matthew 6. So let's start there in Matthew 6. And I'm not sure we'll actually get to 16 today, but maybe. All right? So let's go to Matthew 6 and 33. And we'll start at 31 because you all know this one. And then we're going to read it in Luke, I think. 6:33. You know what? The Bible is so full. The Bible is so full of stuff. Let's just read from 28. And we talked about this last time, but we're gonna drive these things home. And why do you worry about clothes? You know, the reason why these statements are in here is because of what Jesus has already said. That with Jesus you have full provision. He says, don't worry, don't be anxious about anything. And he knows that, and his disciples certainly know that, but when he's talking to people, apparently they don't know that. But they've been told that, because that's why he says, now, why do you worry? When you worry, that means you've gone right into the natural and you're not trusting God. That's what it is. You see, and worry is part of doubt. It's certainly not part of faith. And if you have that in you, then you can have the silver and gold, but you're not going to have the such as I have, I give thee. Because there isn't going to be any power. Because we don't have to do anything except for have the faith. Because he's always going to say, according to your faith, according to your faith, according to your faith. You ever read that in the Bible?
Yeah.
According to your faith. So, why do you worry? See how the flowers of the field grow? You know, this is tough stuff. This is not easy. Someone said one time when I was in college, and so I'm taking a Buddhism class, and they said that no Westerner can ever become a Buddhist. Because of living in capitalism, and the Buddhist who kind of says que sera sera for et to everything, so to speak, we just can't do that because we like money, we like things, and it doesn't mesh with our philosophy, right? That's what they said. But the funniest thing, so Buddhism is an Eastern philosophy, right? And Christianity is an Eastern philosophy? Oh, that's a funny question, isn't it? Is Christianity an Eastern philosophy? Well, of course it's an East. Of course it is. Came from the East, right? And it's very philosophical, yeah. But it just happens to be more. Because although Buddha, half of them declared him to be a god or something like that, he wasn't. He was a philosopher. They should have kept it that way. Jesus, on the other hand, was the Messiah. But people have taken the good teachings of Jesus and have applied them in their life without the power of the Messiah.
That's right.
Therefore, it's a philosophy to them. To others, this is just a nice literature book. No power whatsoever. It's a logos word. The power comes in the rhema. When you mix this with faith, then you see the power. Why does he keep doing that? Am I the only one that worries periodically? I must be the only one.
Yeah.
I don't worry about money. I don't worry about things. I don't worry about the car breaking down. I don't worry about those things, but I worry about my children. And I worry about my grandkids. And I sit there and I go, Lord, I said, am I really, that weak in faith? He says, apparently so. But it passes, because when I feel like that for my kids, it always drives me to pray. Always. So if a tinge of this worry flies through, the enemy is going to get a dose of prayer. And then what happens to the worry? It's cast down. You know, I learned that principle the very first time. We're young. We always went to church. Never missed church. Never missed Wednesday night service. And this was like in 80. And I got sick. And I didn't miss work. But I was sicker than a dog. And I thought, Michelle, I can't go to Wednesday night service tonight. I'm just horrible. I'm not feeling good. She said, okay. She went, took Danielle with her. And I sat in the chair by the fireplace because we didn't have a heater in the house. And I sat there and I go, this is just, there's something not right about this. And I thought, and God just began to speak to me. And then something began to well up inside of me. And it was the fact that instead of talking to God, I started talking to the devil. I said, you put this sickness upon me, and because you did that, I'm going to start praying healing for everybody I know on the planet. And I'm going to believe that they're going to be healed. So, there you go. Amen. The gauntlet is laid down, and I just started praying and praying and praying. And Mom was probably gone 2 or 3 hours. And I prayed till I fell asleep in the chair and woke up totally healed. Amen. So people can't tell me that there's no power anymore. Oh, no. There's no power in some people's lives, maybe. But God's power is still here. It hasn't left at all. Yes, I tell you that even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one. Don't you love that? How many of you have a garden? Raise your hand. Oh, you, all you other pitiful people. You have a garden? You're right. How many people had a garden in the summertime that had a lot of flowers in it? Wow. Oh, you other sad people. Every time I see our garden and with the flowers, I always think of Solomon. I go, just think, all that money and all that stuff, and God, you gave me these, and I can buy a bag of seed for $1 and get all these beautiful flowers. That's cheap. And it's so beautiful and so awesome. God set so many things for up, and we just go through this day, and we miss so much all the time. You know why? Oh, we're just so busy. We're just so busy. I mean, do you ever think about God says he's Jehovah Jireh, right? Jehovah Jireh really means that he's the provider, but he's the provider because he sees ahead of time what to provide. Is he Jehovah Jireh to you?
Yes.
And why do you worry about working and making money all the time? Well, because if a person doesn't work, he's worse than an infidel, right? If he doesn't provide for his family and his kids. Well, God says he'll provide for us. And he's not going to be worse than an infidel. Right? Same rules apply to God. He says he'll take care of us. You got to put your hand to the plow, but he'll provide and take care of us. I mean, this is a full gospel.
That's right. Yep.
Some of these things you go in this natural environment that we live in, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. But in the kingdom of God, it all makes sense. So where do you want to live life? Well, John, I've got to live in this natural thing. No, your body's here. When it said the kingdom came and he rules, it's not here on this earth. It's in your heart on this earth. It's still right now. The kingdom has come. All right, we just need to grow in this. So we're gonna grow. Okay? We're gonna grow. So I got some fun stuff to share. You're not gonna be happy. But it's gonna be fun stuff. Verse 30. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, no big deal. Will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Darn. It's not so bad. He just said, you know what, I'll clothe you. I'll take care of you. But then he had to go ahead and just go, you of little faith. You know, he didn't have to do that. You know, but it is red, right? So the master's saying it. So you of little faith. Okay, so I don't want to be of little faith. Do you know why that a faith of a mustard seed can move a mountain? It's not the faith that's the problem. It's the doubt that nullifies the faith. You've got a mustard seed of faith that's enough. That's all you need. It's enough. It's good. I mean, we're going to build our faith in all these other things we do. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word. We're going to keep listening to the word. We're going to build that faith and get stronger. But if you continue to allow doubt in or a wrong confession, same thing. If you're not lining up to the word of God, if you're not doing a, what is it, 1 Peter 4:11? When you speak the message or the oracles of God. See, if you're not lining up with the word of God, then you're just going to be somewhere creating more doubt. And doubt nullifies that faith. It just makes it impotent, so to speak. And you don't want that. You want faith that moves mountains. You've got to get the doubt out. Yeah. You know? Things come through your mind. Just don't let them come out of your mouth. Okay? Got it? Comes through? Don't let it come out of your mouth. So do not worry saying what we shall eat, what we shall drink, or what we shall wear. For that's what the pagans. What's another word for a pagan?
Heathen.
What's another word for that? How about just a worldly person?
Yeah.
That'd be good. So the worldly people go out and chase after these things? Worldly Christians go out and chase after these things? Christians go out and chase after these things? What's the difference between a pagan and a Christian? If they're both chasing the same thing? Wow, that's a good question. If you're both chasing the same thing, what's the difference? Well, one's saved, one's going to heaven. Going to heaven. But you're not enjoying what he's giving you here. You're not living in it to the fullest here. You can go through life. Let's say you're going to live to be 100 years old. No, 120. Yep. Boop, and die on the 120th day of your birthday. You're checking out and life is, that's it. But you've been miserable. And you have nothing but regrets. All 120 years. That doesn't sound like a whole lot of fun. Does it? Well, the Bible says a lot of stuff. Oh, there we go back to that talk again, huh? The kingdom of God is not just talk, boys and girls. The kingdom of God comes with power. See, we start having revival meetings here. I'm expecting the power of God to move.
Amen.
I am expecting the power of God to move. And we're going to advertise. Bring the sick. Bring them all.
Hallelujah.
Bring everybody. Bring the unsaved. Bring the homeless. Don't you think it's time to get down to the nitty-gritty here?
Yes.
People keep saying, Jesus is coming back soon, soon. You talk like that. But you're not doing anything. If you thought he was coming back, you'd be out there trying to save every person. You don't believe what you're saying. Come on. He's not coming back for a while. Why? He's not coming back till the church gets it together. Can we change that? What do you honestly think? He's actually got a date out there? He didn't have a date. It's going to be whenever we get it together, then he's going to come back. We can speed this whole thing up. It's up to us. It's not up to him. He's saying, let's do it. Get everybody saved. We get that last person saved. Boom. I'm out on the first boat. Always be a pre-tribulationist. Regardless of how you interpret the scriptures, be a pre-tribber. Intellectually, I'm a post-tribber. But in my heart, I'm going on the first boat. Whatever. You guys, you're such hardcore. I'm a mid-trib. I'm a post-trib. See you around like a donut, man. Good for you. Hallelujah. I'm going to be enjoying a whole lot more fun than you. That's all. It's the only difference. You take longer to get there, you miss out on all the fun. What do you think? There's not a lot of partying going on there? I mean, think about it. What's the FOMO? Fear of missing out, right? FOMO. Fear of missing out. You have any clue what you're missing out in heaven currently? Right now? You're missing big time. Oh, man. But we don't ever think about it. What do we got, a world consciousness, but we don't have a heavenly consciousness? We can FOMO this earth, but we don't FOMO the heavens? Wow. What's the matter with us? Talking to me, boys and girls, not to you. The pagans, the worldly people, they run around for all these things. I got a little MG out in my car, my parking lot, half covered, flat tire. It's exhausting me. I got the old truck over there, parked over there, because I blew a radiator hose in it, and it's old too. It's exhausting me. And I spent a whole day looking in the newspaper for a 1960 VW van. Because I want to buy one. That's what I need, you know. Another old car that I can park and look like a junkyard. Make my life complete. If I just had that one car, Michelle. Ben, where's John Porter? Is he here? I was talking to one of the boys and I said, John and Emily got a gigantic piece of property now. We're gonna go in with you and build a gigantic garage so we can all house our extra cars there. On your at your property, but we'll help pay for it.
He's getting nervous back there.
Getting nervous? Nobody's taking this to heart, are they? For the pagans and the worldly people. They run after all these things. Oh, but we don't do that, do we? We don't do that, do we? We? Yeah? How many of you guys, don't raise your hand, have an absolutely empty garage? Aside from you two. These guys are so holy. Giving it all away. All right. Well, give that some thought. I go to people's garages. You literally can't walk through it, let alone park anything in it. Stuff. Things. Stuff and things and more stuff and more things. That's what the pagans do. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them. What? Michelle, pay attention when I'm talking. You're crying out loud. Did you just pick this up? The Heavenly Father knows I need that fan. Now, her response, well, wait till he gives it to you. But Matthew says, but seek first the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom. And then the things will come. The Lord's not afraid of the things, boys and girls. He already knows the things. He says you can have the things. He says, but keep this thing in order. You can have the things. But seek first the kingdom. Just make sure you're doing that first. That's all. He'll give you all the other stuff. Seek first the kingdom and His righteousness. His righteousness.
Amen.
See, that's one of the things. Getting a handle on His righteousness is huge.
Yes,
we're going to talk about that. At the same time that we're talking about the keys of the kingdom. And again, Peter and the rock that the Lord's building the church on. And what the Holy Spirit told Peter in that revelation, saying that Jesus is the Messiah. You're the Christ. You're the Messiah. See, we're coming into powerful times. You know what the times are? We're going to start believing God's word. I mean, we talk about being believers, and we are, right? And we talk about being full gospel believers because we recognize, and we look at the scripture and go, yes. Yes, we believe. But then there's still that action part. Remember, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks? So we really know, regardless of what you say, when all of a sudden the pressure and the heat gets on and these things come out of your mouth, we know you still got some of that in your heart, even though you've said, no, man, I'm good. I'm solid. I'm 100%. Maybe 75%. That's all right, though. God says, let's just keep working on this. Let's just keep going forward, okay?
Amen.
All right, now, let's see. Now I'm going to get to some little more rougher news, okay? Not bad news. Well, first let's go to Luke, the same thing in Luke. Luke 20, Luke 12. Matthew, Mark, Luke 12. And then we're going to get to the other stuff. But I do want to, the difference between Luke 12 and Matthew 6. Okay, so it's the same thing in verse 22. And then verse 27, same thing. Talks about this pagans, the same thing. But in this one, in verse 30, it says, seek His kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. But then I'm going to read on, if you don't mind. So in Matthew, it says to seek first, okay? But in Luke, it just says to seek His kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. But then it's amazing. After that, it says, do not be afraid. I mean, listen to the words of Jesus. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. I mean, this is coming afterwards. Do we know what the kingdom is? Do you have any idea what the kingdom is? I mean, in right now where you sit, can you write down, well, this is what it means, the kingdom, to me? Everybody can do that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so it says, do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased. God's very happy to give you the kingdom. He's happy to give you the kingdom. He wants you to have the kingdom, to be a part of where the king reigns, his dominion, which is basically bringing the principles of heaven down here. And you operating here. How else are you going to move in this power we're talking about? The kingdom has come. But we're so content to just keep going here, do this over and over again. Now I want to tell you something. There's a reality of a couple of things. One is, you're not going to be able to keep doing what you're doing and think, this is just it. I can just keep doing this and keep doing this and keep doing this forever. No. You can't. The whole thing ends when all of a sudden you go, and you're gone. And it's over with. And so many people have been so busy doing all these other things for things. When that time comes, before, you're going to have regrets. You know, in ministry, mostly over at the Christian Center while I was there, that I, and afterwards, you know, as pastors, you visit, you end up visiting people in the hospital and stuff like that. And I think the last three or four people that I went to, and they were going to be dying. They just said they're in the hospital to die, or they're sent home to die. And they were older, and they were dying, and they were going to die, and they knew they were going to die, and they wanted to die. It wasn't anything I could do about it. But I'd ask them. I always did. I said, what would you do differently? Your life is over. What would you do differently? Every single one of them said, I would work less and be with my family more. All of them. See, but we don't get that, do we? Because we're so busy with all this stuff, all these things. Let's forget that part. Let's go to Luke 14. I'm going to run out of time. Start at... Oh, well, let's just read a bunch. We'll start at 15. No, that's not it. 14. Luke 14. Oh, I'm in 13. Luke 14. Verse 15. The great banquet. Who are we talking about with the banquet today? Somebody was talking about the banquet. When one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, well, let's see, what did he hear? Let's back up a little bit. Let's go to 12. When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, Jesus talking, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or the rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back. You really don't want to spend any more time with them than you have to. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, crippled, the lame. So, we could have a banquet service. Huh?
Yeah.
No food, but a banquet service.
Hallelujah.
And go out and invite everybody that people won't invite.
Spiritual feast.
To the banquet service. Wow. Yeah. Invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed. People always say, oh, I want to be blessed. I want to be blessed. There's a formula right there. Go ahead. You can do it, and you will be blessed. You think Mother Teresa was blessed? Oh, you better believe she was blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. There's a payday a-coming. There's a payday a-coming. Not here. There's a payday a-coming. Everybody thinks this is the end. I don't think Christians really think there's a real eternity, but there is. And there's a payday. Oh, how can you use that type of terminology? Because it says there's a payday a-coming. And we can say whatever the word says. When one of those, at verse 15, at the table... heard what he had just said. He said to Jesus, blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. Amen. Well, that's a fact, isn't it?
Right.
Blessed is the one that's going to eat at the feast of and in the kingdom of God. But oh boy, this gets rough. Jesus replied, a certain man was preparing a great banquet, invited many guests at the time. And at the time of the banquet, he sent his... So they already sent out the invitations. He knew these guys were coming. He sent out the invitations. He sent out the invitations already. The plans are all made. You know those little cards? You're telling me you're coming so I can plan on it, because it costs a lot of money to do these things. So thank you for doing that. At the time of the banquet, he sent out his servant to tell those who had been invited, see, they were already invited, come, for everything is ready now. So today's the date, boys and girls. We invited you, we told you about it, and it's coming, and now it's arrived. The day has come. Day has come for those guys. They're leaving town. You see, so many people think that these days are not coming. Oh, the day is coming. There's going to be a day you arrive in Missouri shortly. Oh, a year ago, that would have seemed so far off. Now, oh man, you can see it. It's not that far off anymore. These things are coming down the pike. Come, for everything is now ready. You think maybe the Lord's telling us everything's ready. It's ready in the kingdom. I'm all ready. I'm getting ready to receive the church. Are you guys ready?
Yes.
Are you guys ready? Because it's going to get launched here shortly. Verse 18. But they all alike began to make excuses. Yowzer. Yowzer. The first said, I've just bought a field. I must go and see it. Please excuse me. One version calls this the beg out. Beg out, because each time it says they begged to be let out. Hey, come to the feast. Well, listen, man, I got to take care of this field. And I'm just too busy to come to church right now. And definitely too busy to help. I got to go take care of these other things. See, you got to watch it when you use that word things. Because that's the same vocabulary that the pagans use, according to the scriptures. And Jesus is very clear about the things. He says, I'll give you the things. I'll give you the things. Oh, man, but I'm so busy. I can't go to church. I can't go to Bible study. I can't even get up to pray. I'm so busy. Just bought the field. Please excuse me, God. Another says, I've just bought 5 yoke of oxen. Somebody came to me one time. True story. Literally did this. It was when we were in the lodge 23 years ago here. Came up. I was getting here early to set up the chairs and everything. And this person hopped out of the car, literally handed me their tithe check, and said, here, just wanted to make sure I got my tithe check in, but I can't come. I said, why can't you come? You're here. He goes, I have to go take a shower. Literally. Me and all my humility said, Baha! Who says that? Who thinks like that? Who does those dumb things? People all the time. Why? Dumb things. Dumb things. We always keep getting back to those things. Are those things keeping you from fulfilling God's will in your life? What's getting in the way? Those things that easily entangle you? What is it? Slow down a little bit. Oh, I got to work on Sunday. You mean God doesn't take care of you, but only on Sunday? Is that where your faith level's at? You know, I never worked Sunday. Michelle never worked except for raising kids. Why? Because that's what we chose to do. You know what we said? We said God would always provide for us. You know, so for 20 years, 17 years, you saw Pastor Jeff. He was telling me, You need to be pastoring over here. You need to go be in ministry. You need to do that. I kept saying, no, 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 no. I was making $100,000 a year, and he was making $40,000 a year. And I had six kids, a big house, and all that stuff. And I thought, I got to keep working and make money. And I know how much you get paid, because I'm an elder. And that's all we had. And I kept saying, no, that was it. No way. And Michelle could testify. That's exactly my words. But then he came into that one point in time where I said, okay, I'll pray about it. In 1980, the word came. 1997, John prays about it. You want to know why I couldn't say all these years, you follow me as I follow Christ? Man, you got to be in line if you're going to say that to others. You got to be toeing the line. As soon as we started praying, it didn't even take 2 hours. Holy Spirit just so filled me, and I knew this is what we're going to do. And so you know what we did? We sold everything. Land, property, everything. Got rid of all debt, had nothing. I said, okay, if we're going to do this, I'm going to help God out. Sold everything. Rented a house over here in Big Bear Lake. I go, this will be fine. And then we started going, wait a minute. God can provide. And we started praying a different way. And God always provided. We were sent out with five people, and at the time, and I think two of the couples were tithers and the other ones weren't. I mean, offerings were pretty tiny, but God breathed on every single one of them, and we were never in lack. That was 23 years ago. Yeah. Two ingredients that I left out. I got to work. I'm making 100. He's making 40. I got six kids. This isn't happening. Pray about it. God says, let's do this thing. I'll take care of you. Okay. See, he says he'll take care of you. All you have to do is agree with him and trust him. You still put your hand to the plow, but he gives you favor everywhere you go. Amen. He breathes on whatever it is you're doing. He takes care of those. He may take you all the way to the end of the line. And we have been there before. I'll tell you the story one more time since I have a couple of minutes. So we had maybe three houses that we had that I'd built up here at the time that we owned. And then we were living in a big old house over on Man. It was awesome. The only house up there on Man back in the day. It was us, big old Victorian. And it was good. And all of a sudden, things just began to get a little tight. I had just bought some property. When I say bought, I put $10,000 down. And just time slipped away. Couldn't sell the houses. And all of a sudden, the note comes due. Not a big deal. I'm just going to lose $10,000 or $20,000. Back then, to me, it was a heck of a lot of money. So I'm scrambling. Michelle says, pray. I'm doing everything in the natural. For me to be able to call somebody and get $50,000 back in the day was no big deal. I couldn't get a buck anywhere. I mean, I got houses paid for cash. I couldn't get the money out. It was just weird. Oh, you talk about learning a lesson. I learned so many things the hard way. Going through the wilderness, when God says, John, you can enjoy promised land living here now, or you can go through the wilderness. I don't know why so many times I ended up in the wilderness. But you don't have to be there, boys and girls. You can go a better route. It is promised land living. It does require trusting Him, believing Him, putting yourself in His hands. So, I can't do it. Call my dad. My dad can't help me. And things are just, everything was caving in on me all at once. I thought, okay, I can see this whole thing tumbling apart. I can't remember. It must have been like in 83 or 84 or something like that. I only had 3 kids, I think, at the time. And the note comes due. And I'm going, the note comes due. I go to work. Went to work the next day. Went to work for 3 months. Went to work for 4 months. Sold one of my houses. As soon as I sold one of the houses, the guy that I had the note with calls up and says, "Hey, I forgot about that." He goes, "Your note's due." I said, "You're right." And I had the money because I just sold a house. He never called. The note was due. He didn't call me for 3 or 4 months. No contact whatsoever. Does God know all things?
Oh, yes.
Does He say, "You can trust me"? Even when the notes do? Even when everything just looks so dark? Yeah. But we don't go by darkness. Huh? We trust Him all the way.
Amen.
We trust you, God. Where are we? What verse? 19. Oh, boy. Another said, "I've just bought the 5 oxen. They're so messy. I just got to clean them up, clean up the mess. I just got to, please excuse me." Still another one says, "I just got married, so I can't come. I'm too busy. Man, I can't go to church. I can't help out. I can't do this because I'm too busy. Listen, I got a life. My life's busy." Boys and girls, if your life really is that busy, I don't care what you accomplish here on this earth, you are going to have regrets. There's one way that I know of to not have regrets, and that's to be right smack dab in the middle of God's will.
Amen.
You will have no regrets. He is the comforter. He'll comfort you. That doesn't mean there won't be stuff going on. This stuff's always going to be going on. But it doesn't have to impact you. You talk about taking the high road. God will put you on that high road.
Amen.
Could you imagine the storms are blowing, yet you're not even getting your hair mussed? And you're going right through that. God says He'll protect you. Trust me.
Amen.
But you got to move the chips all in. Ananias and Sapphira held back a little bit. Didn't do them much good. Did it? They both ended up getting carried out feet first. Bad. Bad idea. Lying to God. Doesn't work. These poor guys here, the banquet, the feast. You see, this is all for us. Because that whole banquet, that whole feast, it's already been prepared for us.
Amen.
That table, there's a table in heaven, but there's a table down here.
Amen.
That He has prepared for us. Heck, I was thinking. I mean, could this be the area for the banquet table right here? Where everybody coming to the banquet, and we have people up here and just not talking. But demonstration and power is taking place. Praying for people. You know what I'm believing for? I'm believing for that when people come in, just like at other meetings, during worship, people get healed. We don't even have to pray for them to get healed. They get so caught up in worship. See, the funny thing is, one of the most powerful meetings or times of the presence of the Lord in amongst maybe 100 people in the back row of the Christian Center, powerful, thick. Presence of the Lord was so thick. I mean, I don't know how to describe it. All around you, pressing. And just 100 people just praising the Lord. And I just was so excited. And I said to that girl sitting next to me, I said, "You feel that? You feel that?" She goes, "I don't feel anything. I'm going to move over here." Yeah. Well, you see, God's presence is here. It doesn't mean everyone's going to feel. What are you thinking about God? Or are you thinking about what you're going to do in a few minutes? Are you thinking about God? Or are you worrying about, you know, I got this to do and I got that to do? If I could just get out of here, that would help me out, and I'd feel better about myself. You know, I haven't worn a watch in probably 30 years. Yeah. It's so much better without a watch. It is. Without a clock. Whatever. We could be like the Filipinos. Walk to church, take a day, Fawn Skinners, take a half a day. Right? And then you bring a lunch and a sleeping bag and you stay for a few days. And that's how they have church. If it takes them a week to walk there, what do you think? They're going to come for an hour service? I don't think so. Man, they've come to worship and praise the Lord. Amen. We just have it so easy nowadays, you know? And, you know, it's not like God doesn't want to comfort you. He does. But one of these concerns about in seeking first the kingdom and his righteousness and all these things, seeking first the kingdom, his righteousness and all these things, and that these guys, when the king's inviting them, he's saying, but they got to go out in there. They're doing all these things. And they missed out. And I mean, the king is not happy. And basically said, you guys are not going to have any fun whatsoever, period. The heavenly realm, when we go to heaven, that's a done deal. Okay? But right here is where suffering takes place. You don't have to suffer. You don't have to suffer. We serve God in the midst of challenges and difficulties. The Comforter will comfort you.
Amen.
Can you imagine the Holy Spirit of God literally comforting you? Do you think it's like me coming up and hugging Joe? How's that feel, Joe?
Good.
Yeah, that feels good?
Good.
Can you imagine what it'd be like getting hugged by God?
Wow.
Feel better, huh?
Yeah.
I'm thinking so. Whatever good feelings we could have here with one another. Oh, he's got the real ones. We haven't even gotten close to it. But he says, now's the time. Silver and gold have I none, such as I have, give I thee. Do you have it? Is it in you to give?
Yes, we do.
We haven't been too busy just going out there and seeking all those things all the time? Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. And you don't have to worry about the things of life. Give the Lord a praise, everybody! Woo!